ZOR seminar, so there's, it's a little light this week, but we should be getting some people, so yeah, you're welcome. Thanks for coming. I'd like to introduce you to Matthias Koller, a relatively new hire in BPM. Yeah, so 2013, so enough time to get your feet in. Matthias did his undergrad in Europe before studying in Cambridge and then doing a postdoc in Harvard. It's a little bit of a deviation from our normal stuff in the sense that we're going to be looking at bioinspired materials rather than the optical light, structuring of light and stuff that we often do. So I think it'll be a fascinating kind of deviation from our normal topics. I'm going to stop embarrassing myself now and basically just turn you over because there's going to be a lot of stuff in here that, I think people are going to be very fascinated by. So without further ado,
thank you, Chris. Hopefully I'm speaking loud enough to hear you. But if I trade off, let me know. Get started. So my work is on biological inspiration in optics and photonics. And my background is a bit of a mix between a material scientist, if you want, an engineer in the mechanical engineering department, and before that, a polymer physicist, and a bit of optics. I happen to never have been in a real optics group, so everything that I know in optics is something that I sort of more or less learned myself. And by my supervisors and advisors letting me play around with microscopes that are pretty expensive, but they weren't afraid of me. And that turned out pretty interesting for me. So biological inspiration for optical photonics, harnessing nature's capacities of lightning flight for optical materials. And I'm wondering if there's a difference between two sort of terms that are bouncing around the field. That's one of them is biomimicry, and the other one is bioinspiration. When I think about biomimicry, I think about seeing something and then doing it exactly the same way, because there might be benefits in doing it. Maybe what we see in nature is very interesting for us and has functionality that we want to copy right away. That's biomimetics. Bioinspiration for me is a bit more loosely defined as seeing something and then putting a lot of your own knowledge and your own ingenuity into it and coming up with something that's slightly different or maybe a lot different from the original structure, but maybe better and maybe more adequate to what you want to do. And a lot of our work is more on that field, partly because I think many applications that we want to build can learn a certain amount of things from nature, but then we develop based on what we learn from nature. And also it gives us more freedom to put other materials into the sort of bucket where we mix all the types together and explore more concepts that you might not find in nature. All right, so with that in mind, I want to ask you a couple of questions here. In that context, would it be exciting to you to have access to materials that do that, essentially help the octopus appear out of nothing? And that's a video that I didn't take myself. It's taken by Roger Handler and Woods Hole, just to our associate paper. I wish I would have taken this video. I think it must have been fun to stop the octopus and catch it in exactly that situation. And he told me that he stopped it for about an hour before he could get that shot. But it's incredible when you see how it changes not only color, but also structure, with that very soft, squishy material that it has very good control of. There's a strong neurological network in that skin. And the skin can control the structure of the skin and the color of it, the octopus on the skin. So it's more difference. Second video I want to show that I find very exciting is that one here. Would it be exciting to have materials that can grow and form shapes that then have an optical purpose for something? Like in the crystals that you see here from the Painted Lady, Vanessa Carlton. It's a very common butterfly. You can find them around here. And if you ever go online and you buy butterflies for hatching, for example, to put together the kids, that's likely a species that you would get. It's interesting from the point of view that it has these scales that give it color, so there's a lot of pigment in it. It also has scales that are more transparent and whitish and scattering. So there's elements on these link scales that have interesting photonic properties. And I would find it certainly appealing if you would be able to make something like this in the same way as butterfly does in a synthetic approach, or even harvest some butterflies, biological machinery for growing stuff or stuff. And so that's a paradigm that I think about in terms of optics. Can we make materials that have the same tunability, as we saw in the octopus, for example, or can we make materials that, by growing them, and let them have an optic function, maybe other functions as well. That one here is pretty difficult to spot. We haven't made a lot of progress, so I won't spend a lot of time talking about this. I think my inspiration as a whole is more of an approach than a field, even so people sometimes sell as a field. I think it's an approach that you can take to get inspiration for not only optics and photonics, as I'm trying to, but also material science, or engineering of interfacial phenomena, bioengineering, obviously, and also medical developments. And there is some work in robotics as well. For example, Sam Bickham moves very much like reach. It takes a lot of physiological insights into that problem. Having said that, I want to give you three examples where people very efficiently look at what nature does and then translate this into an artificial useful system. The first example of what the field has nothing to do with optics, but I think it's interesting to transform the concept of bi-informational biometry. And that's the Gecko's way of adhering to almost everything that is not liquid and not too dusty. The Gecko does that by having a lot of different small-scale features, even small-scale features, and even small-scale features on top of that on its toes. So it's a hierarchical structure with different length scales. And it allows it to create a lot of intimate surface contacts with the surface and exploit fundamental forces very efficiently to stick to things that the model goes on the ceiling. And so the group of Mark Kosky in Stanford use the same principle. They just built hierarchical architectures of pads. I think they use a Western United States. And they make finer structures on top of that and finer structures on top of that. And then they can show that at least on very smooth surfaces, glass, which I think are hard to climb for us with their hands, they can climb up. They have a selective release mechanism. That's fully inspired by that Gecko. That's not marked with some of the grad students. I guess at this point it was probably still a bit dangerous, but I told the grad students made it up and down again on a 5 meter wall. So it's very impressive feat, and they published this about, I think it's 2014, but they made a mistake of number. That was last year. Second example I want to show that somebody took inspiration from nature very efficiently and very, very effectively is the work that Tak Sing had done in my former advisor's, postdoc advisor's lab, at John Iceberg's lab. And what they did is they looked at how the pitcher plant gets a snack when it's hungry and coincides when it's also being wet. When it's dry, the ants can just run around on the rim of the plant, but when it's wet, it forms a like a film of water essentially on the surface of the pitcher plant and ants just like into its stomach essentially. Then it just sits. And that's just done by fixing the liquid film on the surface of the plant. And what Tak Sing came up with is a very intriguing technique of using a porous surface, functionalizing it the right way, to then have a lubricant that you can choose, an oil, it could be thrown in or not, adhere very strongly in a way, or be very fine to the porous surface, and forming a liquid layer that covers the solid materials, and have then every other sort of liquid or any other solid material just sliding off as long as it's not miscible. So he just tailors the surface energy set such that you can keep this lubricant film very stable in the porous materials, and then any other liquid will just flow off it. And they're using this, for example, to repel ice. I guess it's very relevant for winters like last in Boston. And he also showed that you can repel oil, and in addition, because it's a liquid film that is stable on the surface, you can stretch that surface. And as long as it doesn't make a lot of damage to the underlying porous structure, or the damage scale is smaller than capillary length of liquid, it can flow back and can heal itself. Services are also self-healing. And for fun, we'll show that you can repair parts. So you have a droplet of jam, very sticky material in an ant, and all behaves like you would see the ant slipping on the picture. Mm-hmm. So very neat concept, taking liquids and like taking about some fractions of expression from the plant and fixing them on the surface and repelling on the surface. And last thing that I want to show in that context is the work that Jeff Karp does at Brigham's Women's Hospital just down the road. He looks at sandcastle worm. He looks at how this tiny creature takes tiny sand grains and builds a bit of a tube for itself and glues these sand grains in the wet environment together. And they took that as inspiration for creating glues that you can use in wet environments, meaning in surgery, and glue tissues together, stitching existing capillaries, not stitching, but gluing, I should say, or putting patches onto incisions that you can make in cardiac surgery. And they also test these patches to help children have holes or something in their heart and basic burst attacks. The advantage is that the glue works in different environments and they can selectively activate it with UV light. So the surgeon has a lot of time to apply the glue and the same, and then they just use UV light and activate the glue so that it sticks. It's a very neat concept. And that's all in sort of interfacial engineering and material centering. I'm going a little bit in a different direction. What we are making is things that are like the octopus structure that I showed you, or at least I want to make this, we haven't made it yet, because that's one of the biggest things that we inspired to. And the reason why I think there is interesting things that we can find in nature also for optic functionality is that nature gives a lot of light for interactions between organisms or organisms of the same kind, different species as well, and it also harvests light, for example, to create sugars and proteins. it had a lot of time to conceive structures that are pretty efficient in what they are doing. Evolution is 3.8 billion years. And if I look at nature, I see this big sort of set of experiments that haven't been started with purpose, but that have been very crucially and strongly selected for the nature of evolution. So any organism that survives, that still does something, or that does something relying on optics for its survival, is doing the optics fairly well, I would say. So they can gain some expression. And then nature's materials are very multifunctional. So they don't only have an optical purpose often, they also have to give a mechanical robustness, shield the organism against the exterior, or provide nutrient flow in and out of the organism's containment, if you want. So can we learn some of these tricks on a shorter time scale is the question that we ask. And so there's two organisms that I find incredibly inspiring for their capacity taking of the properties that their materials have. One of them is this one here. You will find that when it comes out, it's another octopus. But when it's out of this bottle, it's hard to believe that it ever wasn't in this bottle. It also changes its color. It's a nice side effect. And then now when it's coming out, you see that it has a form factor that you wouldn't think it fits into the bottle. Also, the size of the niche background. The confining structure there is its beak. So it cannot go into a hole smaller than its beak because it's a hard structure. And the other one that I find incredibly inspiring is the broadcut paddlefish. I found this on NOAA piece of camouflage. This is real time. The amount of the light dark contrast changes on its skin is something that can control very efficiently. That's just a ridiculous thing for them. And it's using this here for starving spray. So these are sort of materials that I find, I think would be very interesting if you could make them for all these applications. And where we are at the moment, or maybe I should say why I think they would be interesting. I think if you look at nature, we should look at it from an angle of our own needs and purposes and what we can use the materials that we find in nature, or maybe mimic from nature for. And that means that we have to look at situations where we optimize for the same criteria. Well, nature optimizes a lot for visual appearance and contiguity, and that is certainly an interesting optimization criteria for us if we think about cosmetics or films and paints. It optimizes for control of the optical signal, and it can tune that, and that is interesting for displays. And if you think about materials optimization in terms of flexibility and elasticity, tunable and flexible displays would be nice. Nature can encode quite a bit of information in its optical. So this butterfly, for example, uses a structure that's curved concavity with multilayer cladding. And because of curvature, light reflects differently in these concavities, and you get very interesting polarization effects. So you can encode polarization information in there, and that could be interesting for fine growth. And then, as I mentioned, light harvesting is certainly something that we are interested in terms of solar cells, and energy conversion, and all these sorts of things. The things that we are doing in this context are making materials like what you see here are fibers that have a multilayer cladding, and when you stretch these fibers, they change color. It's been originally inspired by the blue fruit, and I'll talk a little bit more about this in a sec. And then we went a little bit further from that and abstracted the concept of things that we learned in this fruit. So these fibers are very similar to what you might know from Joel Fink's work in the research of electronics, but we embedded them with a very different set of materials, so they give us additional elastic properties that you might not get from so many power fibers. Alright, so with that in mind, what we really try to do in my group, at least at this standout, building up my new group, is building a toolbox of multifunctional materials. We look at optics and we look at other properties and see how we can combine them. Fibers are the one. We also look at tunable optics together with a group of Tim Smarter and Norman Sarsfield this year. He's doing some really cool work in terms of building emulsion particles that have interesting optical effects. And so we try to build tunable optics systems with that on a micro scale. Certainly looking into scaling the manufacture of the materials, because if you want to make an impact in terms of industrial production of the materials, we should show that we can make them in larger quantities and not just on the lengths we make 10 centimeters. And then we look into applications of, for example, these butterfly cavities that you saw, how we can combine interesting polarization effects and optics with elastic behavior in, for example, information sets. And localized information sensors on the microscale. Another big aspect of what I'm interested in is the morphogenesis, and I'm going to speak about this a little bit more in the second part of my talk. And we're also looking into how we can hijack some of the natural machinery for manufacturing things that we want to manufacture. find that in South America or Mexico. It's called Buster Pot Berry. And the more pleasing name, the one is Margarita nobilis. I think it has that unpleasing common name because it's tricking birds with its blue color into eating them, in the fruits. But there's no nutritional value in its fruits. So they're just very cellulosic, paper-like fruits that you bite into them. They have very pretty color. When you look at these, and that's work done by Peter Vukusic and one of the students at the Lethbridge at the University of Exeter. When you look at these fruit surfaces, you find these long elongated cells, and they're stacked in several layers. But what's really exciting about these cells is that they're very full of stuff. They have this concentric layer architecture of dense tissue. And when you stain this tissue and you take a TEM image of that, you see that there is a perivisicular structure. I'm not implying that these are different materials. You could think from first view that these might be multilayers, but it could also just be a cellulose crystal that's rotating as it goes with time. So when you cut through that, you expose different cross-sections of the cellulose crystal arrangement, and that stains different. It's actually very interesting work of a group in Cambridge, as I say, there being an who studied a fruit that grows in Africa, and has very similar features, to it's violet, and it has no relation to their food is a bit of a conversion evolution. But they showed there is a chiral cellulose crystal that is responsible for the reflection. And the pitch of the cellulose crystal is creating the earth. So this seems likely to be the same structure. When we looked at this in the beginning, we thought, okay, what's important is the periodicity of the nanoscale and the curvature of the microscale. Nanoscale periodicity gives you the filtering, like in a multilayer interference filter. The curvature of the microscale just disperses the light in a broad angle range so that the food can be seen from a lot of different. And so we started out just playing with that, and we thought it might be interesting to make a material like that. And what we were setting out to was simplifying it to the point where we just thought about fibers similar to what Joel Fink's group had done in the fall of 2002, 2003. The key there was that we wanted to build with different materials to make it more tuned and more flexible. I usually use a slide to explain what multilayer interference is, but I guess I could probably skip this here unless you want me to talk about this. So maybe only one word, the effect is based on the fact that you have several different optical interfaces where you reflect light, and then all these reflections come out at the top of the surface, and if you have right spacing, you get constructive interference for these different reflections for a given color. And that means that you have a nice handle because you can tune the thickness if you're bound to certain tools and change the color spectrum that you get constructive interference in the reflection. So I showed you this fibers before. The fact that they tune their color, the fact that they're based on multilayer means that they change the thickness of those fibers, as you can imagine. And so we can do this post-processing. Actually, we'll talk about how we process or how we process these fibers. And that is instead of using a preform that has microscopic features that we then can pull down like optical fibers and get into the microscopic range, like in control for these fingers, we spin cast an elastomer. And then we cure that and spin cast a second elastomer on top of that. Very cool materials, an S-polygon to silicone, and pull the second S-polygon to polymers. And then we roll it up. And we use a little trick to roll in that. We just spin that, or at least not spin the confinement film to a wall surface. And so this tension keeps it flat. And then we attach a fiber to it and roll it. And you can automate that so they don't have to spend a lot of time doing it by hand. At the moment, we make fibers. Of about 10 centimeter length because we are bound to the size of our spin folder being something that appears with 6 centimeters and not above. And so for making one fiber for 10 centimeter length, I think if you are in the routine, it takes you about 10 minutes. And that's probably too slow for 10 centimeter fiber. I'll tell you a bit about how we scale. But we make these fibers from these two materials, they're elastic, and you can put them on elastic fibers and then you can stretch them. I want to show a high magnification image of internal structure. What you see here is a cross section with a glass core that grows about 10 micrometer in diameter. The cladding here is another 30 micrometer thick. We have about 70 layers in this cladding. And here you see high magnification image of the cladding itself. So it's a very regular alternating structure between one and the other. We can just by changing the spin speed on the spin coder drive the thickness of the films in the production. And we can get anything from blue to red in reflection color. So this is light shining onto the fibers and then reflecting off it. And the complementary color will shine through transmission because we use no absorber in these materials, either nanotransparent. So you essentially just have a very simple filter, like like a micellar filter that you find in your growing mirrors in the microscope, except for the curved depth filter.
There's a couple of different things that we can do in terms of playing with that geometry of these fibers. If you think about how we make them, we can just attach the core fiber at the end of the film and roll it up, and we get one very distorted film. If we attach the fiber somewhere away from the edge of the film, we flap the film back onto itself in the first part that we roll up. So we get two different curves, one being double of the, or the other being double the curvature of the double period of the outer layer. And that means you get a more richer sort of spectral landscape. You create an immediate peaks between your fundamental and your higher order peaks for the synapse. And then there's another game that we can play. We can just fix the distance between the fiber point and where we have the other end of the film, not releasing from the paper fully. And then we can create a chert layer. And that means you can create a broadband reflector. Depending on where you start out with your thickness, you might get something that's called muscle. And what we're trying at the moment is playing a little bit more with creating defects in the cladding itself. A simple thing is that we can just roll up these defects, for example, the thinner fiber that we incorporate into the rolling thicker fiber, and that way we can pattern these structures better. But we haven't made too much progress on this yet. This is something that we are trying to figure out what we can win with. Well, there's one other parameter that we have because we assembled the cladding separately from the core, and that is that we can play the core itself. And what you see here are fibers that we extrude or print, depending on how you want to call it. I sometimes call it printing because we can change the makeup of the fibers during extrusion. And this is done by Jennifer Lewis at Harvard, and actually the person who was really done was James Harden, the postdoc. But James can print these transparent cores. He can also make cores that are absorbing, that have pigment in them. He can alternate these materials, and he can also start to create a different sort of thickness or morphology on these cores. So we have an extra handle of playing with the internal structure of these fibers. And so these are interesting for example because you could argue that different ranges of these fibers take strain differently, and so we get a variation in the spectral response on the fiber. Here, you could argue that what's interesting between black and white, or transparent, is that the transparent fiber has a problem that in a complex light environment like here, you get lipophonic inflection, but you also get transmissive components. So that obviously adds up to the spectrum that you ultimately see. And that might depurify the colors of these fibers, depending on the lightings of the conditions. So we make these transparent fibers, make fibers with black core, because then you only have reflection colors, and the colors come out stronger in suboptimal lighting settings. But then you would have other components here where light would only come through in reflection, and here you could get light through transmission of these fibers. And that's transfers. So when we take those and we put them in our little setup, we can stretch them 10,000 plus times, I guess. That's what we've shown so far. You see how the fiber color changes as a function of strain. And we can go multiple cycles. If that is the microscopic image of the setup microscopically, that would look this way. What you see here is a microscopic image of the fiber surface. Actually, we focus on the core here, of the surface, and then the reflection spectrum that corresponds to that given color. What I want to point out is that these reflection peaks are pretty narrow, and we can play with this with the material composition, obviously, because if you have reflective images that are closer together, you get a narrow bandgap. If you have reflective images that are wider apart from each other at higher contrast, you get a wider bandgap. We can purposefully take different sort of thicknesses of the layers and tune that to get these peaks a little finer, to get just in pure color. The other thing that we have as a handle is a number of layers. Low refractive index contrast means you need more layers to get enough reflections through the layers, but we roll 60 to 250 layers, so that's not a problem. If you have a high refractive index contrast, you can get away from these less layers. What's really nice about these fibers is that we can predict how they perform. And what we show here is peak waveness of the reflection we saw before, plotted against strain that we apply. So these are data sets for different peaks, reflection peaks of the fiber. You see the error bars here, that's for 15 times stretching, cycling it. We're now having experiments going that can allow us to stretch it 1,000 times or maybe 10,000 times to see how it performs and how durable it is. The nice part is that there's a very simple relation that comes. sort of elasticity theory that predicts the peak measurements as a function of strain. And the relations are here, the C1 coefficient here, and that's the Poisson spatial. And if we fit this data in scale, we fit it, we find the Poisson spatial 4.46 that happens to be the Poisson spatial for the materials that we use. So it's very nice because then that means that we can apply some strain, use that equation, and predict what color variation we would get for the strain. Or vice versa, if we read about a certain color, we know it's a certain strain. And that should give us access to a couple of different applications, I hope. And that's what I always say in my current applications, at least. One of them is structural network learning. If you're interested in large scale deformations, these fibers might be able to pick up these deformations as a change in color. Color dynamic textiles are certainly interesting if you have textiles that change as you stress them and strain them. One other application would be, for example, suturing, robotic surgery. And that came out of a discussion with Rob Howe at Harvard, when we first published our paper on that. And he was saying that it might be very interesting to give a surgeon that does the suturing with robotic tools at the end of each operation a bit of an indicator in his suturing fibers, so they know how much strain they put on his fibers. Because at the moment, they take two stitches, and then they make a knot out of fear that they rip the filament and open up the suture. So maybe they can do this, this process a bit more efficient with these sort of small indicators. Bandages are maybe a little bit easier than that. What we are playing with at the moment is just weaving a couple of indicators into a compression bandage. The problem there being for surgeons and doctors that they only get the pressure right about 30% of the time if they want to, for example, treat ulcers. So they have to then open up the bandage again, check what happens, and then reapply a different amount of pressure. If we can tune these fibers such that they show, let's say, green color at the right pressure range, red or blue anywhere else, maybe that is something that can help them to find this pressure range more often than 30%. The bandage has the optimal healing effect. Same thing for pressure indication in hospital mattresses. If patients have paraplegia, they can't move their legs until they're sitting on the same spot of skin as the bandage, but they will have ulcers. If we can create an indicator that's optical, maybe that shows up earlier there's pressure points and there are people that we don't have. We had one proposal that we didn't get funded, unfortunately, with the NFL, where we said that we could apply these layers as pressure indicators, or impact indicators, I should say, on football helmets. So you mesh a layer of that on the outside of the helmet, and they knock into each other. If the material is sufficiently viscoelastic, it would show a deformation, maybe up to 30, 50 seconds after the impact, and then it would be just enough for them to set up again. But the color check would show the impact strength. And then we were also discussing how we could complement this with internal sensors inside the padding, right next to the head that's really formed, and measure that with a small wireless sensor. I was really thrilled about it because one of my students is fanatic about football. I think if we would have gotten this grant, he would have excelled in the project. Probably had these helmets by now, but didn't get enough. So I'm still trying to find money for that sort of more practical application. Another thing that we've been discussing in the past with Alberto Rodriguez from mechanical engineering as well, he's very interested in manipulators, could we potentially provide an optical indicator for tactile cues and feedback, especially if you have, for example, a robotic manipulator or a prosthesis, and you're just learning to use that, that would help you gauge the force range that you apply onto a certain object, glass, microphone, things like that, maybe with transducing some of the pressure into a color response that manipulates the pressure. So the display of tactile stimuli we should use. But I think there's a range of applications that we can aim for. Now the shortcoming is, as I said, we only make these fibers that short. And so, especially here, you could imagine that the shirts that we could weave from them are pretty tiny. Not even my son's with them. And so there is these open challenges that we work on these materials at the moment. One of them is showing that they're actually durable. And so my student has just finished building a setup where we can do the mechanical testing of fibers with a simple tensing meter if you want. That has the capacity of stretching fibers. You can see a fiber here, if you look very carefully. And it also measures the strain,